Over the past couple of weeks, we've been looking at Entity Framework Core, but we've got to remember, Entity Framework isn't just a technology that we can use with .NET Core, it's also available with the older .NET Framework. And in fact, it came into .NET Framework with Visual Studio 2008, and the latest version is Ef6. And so this week, we're just going to be looking at some of the differences between Ef Core and Ef6, really only the major ones. For the most part, although they're different technologies, Ef Core was a rewrite of Ef6. In programming terms, they work in similar ways. So we're only going to need to focus on the key differences. The one important thing to bear in mind, though, is if you are writing a .NET Framework application, you're not forced to use Ef6. You can still actually use Ef Core in a .NET Framework application. Now, if you've already got an existing Ef6 application, I wouldn't necessarily start porting it. But if you haven't, and if you're starting anew, you might want to consider using Ef Core. But we're going to look at Ef6, see how that works. And what I've got here is I've set up on the project we're working on last time, just a couple of other libraries. We've got an Ef6 code first, an Ef6 DB first, and then just an Ef6 console that's going to allow us to display these things. And we're going to begin, like we did with Ef Core, with the code first. And if we take a look in there, you'll see all I've done is actually just copied over exactly the code we had before. So we've got a couple of entity classes, our author and our book. And there's absolutely nothing different about those at all, because there was very little in them in the first place that made it obvious that they were there for Entity Framework. We then also had our books context derived from DB context, and you'll see we're getting a few errors in here, mostly because I haven't yet included the libraries. There will be a few changes here, but we still have things like a base class called DB context and a collection called DB set. And then in the console application, for now, I've just got the same sort of fake data that we had last time to create some books and populate the database. And again, we're getting a couple of issues because of different libraries. So the first thing I've got to do is introduce the libraries. So what I'll do in my Ef6 code first, I'm going to do an add new item. And then if I go to data, we can see we've got this ADO.NET data model. So I will call this books model. Click add. So now we can see the four ways that we can create an Entity Framework 6 data model. Some of these are going to be familiar. Code first from database. Remember, we looked at in Ef Core, so that's what we had to type scaffold DB context for. What we're going to look at now is just empty code first model. So this is just the straightforward code first way. We've already written the code. We're going to generate the database from it. And then the other two are what's actually different in Ef6, and we'll look at those later using the visual designer. But let's just get going with the empty code first model and click finish on that. And all that's doing is adding in the packages that give us the Entity Framework library. Could have gone to NuGet for that, but I can do it this way as well. In fact, it's done a bit more than we need because it's added this class books model derived from DB context. And we'd already done that. So actually, I would just at this stage throw away that books model because we've already done the work. And if we look now in our books context and just add the appropriate namespace, then we can see it knows what DB context is. It knows what those DB sets are. What it doesn't like is this DB context options. And that way of configuring our database is actually something that's different between Ef6 and Ef Core. So that can go. But apart from that, everything else in our code first library is okay. If we go to our console program, I said that the way these things are set up is a bit different, so we're going to get rid of that options builder. That's, remember, called books context. Doesn't take any options. And also, because we're in framework now, this is C# 7, not C# 8, and so I've actually got to have a using block rather than simply a using statement. And also, we don't anymore have this ensure created, so all that's got to go. You can see we've got one extra problem. We've just got to install the package in this console application as well. So we'll just use the current version. And now everything's happy. So we create the fake data. And then I'm not going to bother with printing out the data at this stage. We just want to get it into the database. So we'll just add it to the DB context, save the changes. And if we run that up, just make sure that's our startup project. Then we'll see that just like before, it'll take a little while because it is now creating the database and it finishes perfectly happy. Something you may be thinking, hang on, we haven't done this yet. We haven't actually specified anything about the nature of the database we're going to create there. So we haven't specified a connection string. We haven't even specified what technology we want to do this with. You remember last time when we were using Entity Framework Core, we had to specify that we were going to use the SQLite and that that was where the file was going to be located. But we've done none of that. And this is one of the first differences you notice with Entity Framework 6 and Entity Framework Core. If you don't specify anything with Ef6, it just makes some default assumptions. And if we go to our SQL Server Object Explorer, look under my default installation, which is just this local DB, look under databases, and there you can see it's given us Ef6 code first.books context. So if we look at our books context, that is the fully qualified name with the namespace plus the name of the class. So it's done a couple of things in defaulting all the settings there. It's gone for the default database installation on my machine, which was SQL Server, MS SQL Local DB, the one that comes with Visual Studio. And also it's defaulted the name of the DB context to Ef6 code first.books context, the name of the DB context class we had. And that seems really nice. Certainly for me, as someone who demos this quite a lot, it's nice that I don't have to worry about that. In practical terms, though, it doesn't make much sense. Whenever you're doing this for real, you will want to specify those things. And that's one of the differences between Ef Core and Ef6. Ef Core just forces you to specify it, which is a tiny overhead when you want to do a really quick demo, but is far, far better when you're really working with this as serious code. But that's what we've got there. Let's now just look at the contents of that. So that should have been populated if we look in tables, and we can see if we say authors. There we've got Jane Austen, Ian Fleming, books. We've got the six books, we've got the foreign key. Everything worked in very much the same way. Let's do the reverse of that now. Let's take the database and generate the code from it. Now we did this in Ef Core using what was called code first from database. That's also available in Ef6, but we're not going to do that because it's so similar. We're going to look at something slightly different. So if I go to my Ef6 DB first package and then do a similar thing to what we did before. So let's add a new item, go to data. Again, we'll go in here. We'll call this our books model once again. Click add. Go for the options here, but this time, although I could do another code first from database, which would be very similar to what we had there, I'm going to go for this EF designer from database. I'll mention what this empty EF designer model is in a moment. It'll become pretty clear, but we're going to go for the EF designer from database. So click next in there, and then we're going to make a new connection, and it's going to be SQL Server because that's where the database was. And then I'll type in here the name of the database. So local DB. MS SQL Local DB. Then if we drop down there, we go for the one we just created. So again, just doing the process in reverse. Do a quick test, see if we can connect to that. That's happy. And then click OK on that. And it's given us this connection string, quite complicated. These are horrible to work out. But also it's say, what do we want to save that in the app config? And let's call this our book context. Click on next. We're going to go for Entity Framework 6. And now it looks at that database and we can see all the things that are in there. That migration history, I'll be talking more about in a later video. We don't need to worry about that for now. I'm just going to select authors and books. Remember something we were talking about last time with pluralization, the fact that tables tend to have plural names and classes have singular names? Well, if we keep that checked, it will work out what's going on there. And I think everything else we can leave as a default. Click finish. And what it's now going to do is read all that data in from the database. But it's going to do things slightly differently from what we had with the code first from database. In that it gives us what we wanted in this diagrammatic form. So you can see here, it's got the author, it's got the book. Notice largely from the fact those names are singular, this is not a database diagram, this is a class diagram. So this is a diagrammatic representation of the classes it's generated for us. But we can see we've got the author has a name and has a collection of books. The book has a title and a year of publication and an author. And we can also see, if we click on one of these, down the bottom here, we've got these mapping details that tells us that the author class maps onto the author's table. We can see the columns, and you can see there, nvarchar is a database type, whereas string is our .NET C# type. So you can see we've got the mapping there. And if we wanted to make any changes to that mapping, then we could actually do them directly in here. So if I wanted to, say, change year of publication to something slightly different, like publication year, then I could change it in there. And if we look at that mapping again, we can see that it's still year of publication, the column name in the database, but it's now publication year, the property name in the class. We can also see we've got the model browser. That's another way to look at that information. But actually, what we're really looking at here is it's generated an EDMX file. So EDMX stands for Entity Data Model XML. And that is really the definitive document of what's going on here. So what we can see in the diagram and in the mapping details, that's all just a view of the information actually in the EDMX. So if I save my changes there, and then we can look in the EDMX in its raw form, and what we can see, if we open it as just an XML document, is this is what we've actually got in there. So it basically stores all the information about the database, which is what it puts in this storage model sections. So there you can see the year of publication, for example, as type int. Then it has the conceptual model. That is the class structure in C sharp. And in that one, you can see it's got publication year as an int 32. And then it has the mapping. And in there, you can see it's mapping publication year onto year of publication. So that's how it reconciles any differences with what we have in our database compared to what we have in our classes. But what we can also see is the vast majority of this information is redundant, because although it's useful to say publication year maps onto year of publication, it's obvious for everything else. It's obvious that ID maps onto ID, that title maps onto title, that name maps onto name, and so on and so forth. So remember what we said with Ef Core, that it follows the approach of favoring convention over configuration. Now that's also possible with the Ef6 as well, but if you use this EDMX, it's all about configuration. Every piece of information, even though it's an absolutely obvious mapping, has to be stored. And that's why we get this big EDMX file, although easier if we look at it in the diagrammatic form rather than looking at all those details. But the EDMX file is what's definitive. That's really the thing that you're going to put back into source control. And if you make any changes, updating the database structure, whatever, it's going to be the EDMX file that you go for. If you remember, we had an option just to create an empty EDMX file, and you could do that if you wanted to do everything from scratch, and you could actually use that to generate both the database and the classes. But in this case, we've already got the database, so we've used that. We can see, again, rather like in the code first from database, that it's created for us an author class, a book class, title, publication year, that sort of thing, and also a context. So that's what we can use, our book context, that we've got it there with a few slight differences. But again, thing to bear in mind, notice it's given us a really big warning here. We can't change these because these will get regenerated from the EDMX file whenever the EDMX file changes. And that means, again, just like last time, if we want to add new methods or anything like that, we've got to do that in a separate file. So let's get on and do that. So let's do a new folder called additions. And I will actually steal the code I had before from the Ef Core. So there we've got our additions, remember. Let's take both of those and pop them into our additions down here. Couple of changes. We've got to change the namespace to EF6 DB first. and then also change that to the singular. And now we can see that's happy. And then do the same in books. Change that as well, because we changed the name, of course. And we can see, because that's partial, that's going to map together. So that's really the same idea we had before, that if you've got generated code, you don't want to alter it, you want to use partial classes to hook things up. But now that we've done that, let's go to our console. And then rather than using the books context that we had before, so I'll change that to book context, introduce the using directive for that, and probably for safety, I better remove previous one, because we have got things with similar names like author. So that's all happy. We can just comment that out because we're not going to be using the fake data anymore. And then we're not going to be storing any of that, so we can get rid of that. But we are going to be displaying it. So again, we've got our link query that's going to give us all of the books since 1900. Now, you'll also notice it's giving us an error on that include. Remember that we discussed last time was for the eager loading. Well, although you can have eager loading in Entity Framework 6, it really does push you towards the idea of lazy loading, which we said is probably a bad thing, but it just means these things work more simply, even if they don't work as efficiently. And so now if we run that, we can see I forgot a very important thing. When we generated the Edmx file in here, it also generated for us an app.config, and that is where it put the connection string. So remember when I created this, it asked me if I wanted to store the connection string, and that put it in there. However, when you're running the program, it doesn't look at the app config for the library. The console will be looking at its own app config. So one of the things you have to remember to do, and I'd forgotten, is take that and copy it into the app config for your console application. And so now when I run that up, we can see we're getting the list of the books since 1900. So in the end, we get pretty much exactly the same behavior we had with Entity Framework Core, but instead of doing the code first from database, where it simply directly generated C# code from the database, we did this DB first, where it creates this intermediate EDMX file that we can do the work from. Just one quick thing to point out there, what that last thing I did was copying over the connection string. You might be tempted to actually delete the connection string from the library app config, but I'd be cautious about doing that, because if we go back to the EDMX file, you'll notice if ever we change the database, we can do this update model from database. And when you do that, to find the database, it uses the connection string locally for the library. So you do need to have that connection string in the app config for both the library and for the executable console app in its case. We saw there one of the key differences as well, the fact that in EF6, we get the idea of lazy loading automatically. And in fact, we have to turn it off if we don't want it. So if I go to the program, if I didn't want to have lazy loading, I would have to say db.configuration.lazyloadingenabled equals false. So it is still optional in Entity Framework 6, but we can see the options reversed. Next time, I'm going to be talking about the details of that, why lazy loading is such a bad idea, and why eager loading is a better way to go. So that's what we'll be seeing next time, but hope you enjoyed that. A little bit historic, because EF6 is quite old now, but it's useful, I think, to see how it works. Any comments, do put them in the section below. Do subscribe, and I'll see you next time.